Hi, this is Joseph Anthony of TappingWithMusic.com. Thank you so much for stopping by. Today I'd like to do another Waldorf-inspired teaching video. And I'll start by saying, you know, these are my ideas based on my understanding of Rudolf Steiner and Waldorf education. These do not represent OSNA or my school. These are just Joseph's thoughts. And I'd like to turn our attention to the closing words from Practical Advice to Teachers, 14 lectures that were given at the foundation of the Waldorf School from August 21st to September 5th, 1919. This is really very practical stuff on how to teach various subjects. But he talks at the end about four principles that he wants to leave these fresh, eager, nervous, excited teachers with. And I think they apply to all teachers today. New Waldorf teachers, old Waldorf teachers, any teacher in any school system or philosophy. We could, you know, come up with millions of little nuance rules and stuff, but he gave us four guiding principles. And I'd like to talk a little bit about them. The first one that he gives, I'm just going to read it and then we'll talk about it. Firstly, the teacher must see to it that he or she influences and works upon their students in a wider sense by letting the spirit flow through their whole being as a teacher, and also in the details of their work, how we utter each single word, how we develop each individual concepts or feelings. The teacher must be a person of initiative. We must be full of initiative. We must never be careless or lazy. At every moment, we must stand in full consciousness of what we are doing in the school, how we behave with the children. This is the first principle. A teacher must be a person of initiative in everything that they do, great and small. So, we have the four guiding principles from Rudolf Steiner. Number one, be a teacher of initiative. I want to make sure I spell it right. Yeah, there we go. Thank you. Ha! Be a teacher of initiative. Then what on earth does that mean? To me, it means having a conscious relationship with the spiritual world, a meditative life, an inner life. Initiative, it's hard not to notice how close that word is to initiation, right? Initiation into what? Into the devotion, the calling of being a teacher. And he talks about not being lazy, and being conscious in everything that we do, even the details. And I read in details. I read prep work, I read meetings, I read emails to parents, how we tend the physical space of our room. So how on earth do we become a person of initiative? Right? He gives us the hint. Develop a meditative life, a connection with the angels. And other ways we can do that, that he doesn't mention, that help me, that I'll offer you, having good, healthy conversations with my colleagues, reading Rudolf Steiner, coming up with my own ideas, my own understanding. It's wonderful to borrow morning lesson book ideas, songs, poems, sometimes why reinvent the wheel. They're there, and if they fit your class, go ahead and use them. But also, show the initiative. Initiate yourself and develop an art, a skill. Do some drawings, do some writing, write some poems, write some songs, write some stories for your students. Don't worry about what anyone's going to say or other. Just have fun and do it. If you see something needs to get done, do it without any thought of acknowledgement, praise, appreciation. Just do it. Initiate something healthy in your school, for your colleagues, for the parents of the school, for your own students. So be a person of initiative. That is the first thing. Trying to think if there's anything else I want to say about that. Yeah, it is about initiation into the life of creativity, the art of education. So knowing the developmental stages of the children, knowing Waldorf pedagogy in a way that it's alive in us, so that we can form our own ideas with humility and fun. So, first thing, be a teacher of initiative. The second guiding principle that he gave, secondly, my dear friends, Rudolf Steiner writes, we as teachers must be interested in everything that is going on in the world and in all that concerns mankind. All that is happening in the outside world and in the life of men must arouse our interest. If we as teachers were to shut ourselves off from anything that might interest human beings, it would be a deplorable thing. We should take an interest in the affairs of the outside world, and we should also be able to enter into all the concerns, great and small, of every individual child in our care. This is the second principle. The teacher should be one who is interested in the being of the whole world and of humanity. Be interested in the world. Guiding principle number two. This is a funny one because, you know, we're often, most people immediately equate that with media. Oh my gosh, I don't want to watch TV, I don't want to go see movies, I don't want to, Facebook, ugh, Araman. Sorry. He doesn't just mean that. He puts it in the context of the cares and concerns, great and small, of your students. So, you know, you have a first or second grader or any age student. They come to you and they have, you know, they're worried about, so you can tell something's up. And they may say something like, you know, that ladybug just got hurt, or my cat is, or so-and-so, this happened at home, or so-and-so is doing. Look at those things as messengers of concern and be interested in them. Give them your attention. Don't just brush them off as inconsequential. You've got better things to do. Be interested in these things. Be interested in the world. Somewhere Steiner says, if you want to know yourself, get out into the world. So be engaged with the world. I go so far as to say, know the books your students are reading in and out of school. Know what video games they play, what TV shows they watch, what movies they watch, what videos they watch on YouTube. Find that stuff out. Not to encourage it. Know what sports they like. Who their favorite athlete is. Find these things out. Not to encourage media use, but to show them that you are interested in their lives. It'll help you have conversations. These things, who's your favorite athlete or baseball player or whatever, can be a doorway into a deeper, more meaningful connection with that student. It may bring up something that you need to know for them, to teach them. So be interested in the world, whether that is media related, or your neighborhood, the neighborhood that surrounds your school. Go for a walk, get to know who's around your school. And again, this isn't about encouraging all that stuff of media. But it's about knowing it in such a way where you can connect and converse and enter the world of your children without judgment. Right? If they sense our disdain for the media stuff that they might be involved in, you know, they pick that up. And that's who they are. So it's, you know, it condemns them inside. I just fractioned my chalk. I love when I break my chalk and say that to my students. Anyway, so be interested in the world. And another way to do that is, you know, have home visits. Have chats with the parents. Have little chats with your students on recess or invite them to your desk at lunchtime, right? Converse with them. Talk with them. Don't just talk at them. Talk with them. Be interested in their concerns, great and small, Steiner says. And be interested in the world. It doesn't mean I have to watch the news every night. I don't watch the news at all. It's yicky. Yeah, it bothers my brain. But I do need to know what's going on. Because some of my students may have the radio on the way to school. And they may ask me a question about a current event. So I need to be interested and awake to the world. With wonder and compassion and insight. I am the living example of the person in the world. I don't want to be a Waldorf teacher. Celebrate the world of nature, celebrate society, and find the things in your culture that are meaningful and interesting to you so that you can better teach your students. Guiding principle number 3. Thirdly, Steiner says, the teacher must be one who never makes a compromise in their heart and mind with what is untrue. The teacher must be one who is true in the depths of their being. He or she must never compromise with untruth. For if we did, we would see how through many channels untruth would find its way into our teaching, especially in the way we present our subjects. Our teachers will only bear the stamp of truth if we are intently striving after truth in ourselves. Our teaching will only bear the stamp of truth if we are intently striving after truth in ourselves. Oh my gosh, how on earth do you do that? That's a heavy one, isn't it? Never. He uses that word. I don't really like the word never or those. The word never or always. To me, they're fantasy words and they're really, it's hard to say those two words to me. But he uses it here very dramatically and I believe purposefully. Guiding principle. I'm going to use the 12-step term, rigorous honesty. Gosh, golly, I hope I spelled it right. Rigorous honesty. Doesn't mean brutal honesty, that I get to say whatever I feel like saying to my students, parents, colleagues. I don't believe that's at all what he's talking about. I believe he's talking about being true to yourself as a child of the divine, being true to your calling, being true to your own understanding of the Waldorf pedagogy and the developmental stages of children. Being true to your class. Letting go of the worries of what others may think or say. To thine own self be true. That requires inventory. Self-inventory. So, at the end of the school day, take 5 minutes. 10 minutes. 5 minutes. And review the day. What you did well, what you didn't do well. Real objectively, as if it were a different teacher unrelated to you. Just objectively, without judgment and nasty self-condemning thoughts. Look at your day. What could I do better? At the end of the day and you're going to sleep, review your day. Go through it backwards. Observe yourself without judgment or self-condemning nature of things. Just look at what you did. What can I do better today, tomorrow? And sometimes, because we're so emotionally wrapped up in ourselves and our situation, it's good to have a spiritual advisor, a mentor, a friend, a colleague you can go to and say, man, I don't know if I'm doing this right, or man, I made this mistake, or what do you think, or Tell me. We need people who will call us on our shit. Oh, sorry. Kinda. Who can call us on our stuff. Right? If we get off somewhere in La La Land. Help keep us grounded. So the truth of our calling. And if we don't, he says, it'll wind its way. If we're untrue, it will wind its way into our teaching. So we have to be self-aware. And again, referring to that quote, if I want to know myself, I better get out into the world. That world that he says we ought not to be condemning or shunning. Get out into the world. Engage with other people. Have healthy, meaningful conversations with your colleagues and other people. And it will help you know yourself. Study things. Be open-minded. Luckily, he says, intensely striving. So he gives us a little out. Because we're going to lie. It's going to happen at some point. We're going to fudge. We're going to omit something. Keep the connection with the angels alive in you, with your teacher meditations, your own personal meditations, your prayers. And also, continue to develop an artistic pursuit, music, drawing, painting, dancing. The more we do something creative in the arts, we have to be honest with ourselves to be that kind of channel. So, I wouldn't worry too much about that one in the sense of beating yourself up. Strive after it with intensity and use other people to help you. All right, number four, the last one. And now comes something which is more easily said than done, but which nevertheless is also a golden rule for the teacher's calling. Next principle, the fourth one. A teacher must never get stale and grow sour. Cherish a mood of soul which is fresh and healthy. No getting stale and sour. This must be the teacher's endeavor. So the last principle, right? Stay fresh and healthy, right? We'll stick that in there, that's important. All right, so how on earth do we do that? How do we stay fresh and not grow stale? So I think of a piece of fruit that's been sitting around and it's not being used, not being touched. And after a long time of that orange or piece of bread sitting there, the piece of bread, it'll just go stale if it's just sitting there. Orange is just going to go sour if it just sits there. It's just going to rot. So if we let our inner lives go untouched because we're too busy, it's so easy to be busy in things that really don't matter. In the long run, it is for me. Use up my energy doing all these little things that make me feel busy and like I'm doing something, but I'm not doing anything at the end of the day. So, in Balance of Teaching, and I think in Foundations of Human Experience and other places, Steiner talks about studying the things that he talks about in terms of child development and anthroposophy, and study students and the spiritual realities, the fourfold nature and all that stuff, the etheric, the astral, the will, the ego, study that stuff. Come up with images that relate to your students and yourself. And he says, when you do those kinds of active studies of your students, meditatively, prayerfully, it will enliven you, invigorate you, energize you, inspire and sustain you. So keep studying, keep observing. And I'm going to add, have fun, for crying out loud. Read some Wodehouse. Read Steiner on a regular basis. Chocolate is good. Cultivate fun, easygoing relationships with your colleagues. Socialize in and out of school. Don't add stuff, right, and make the lives of your colleagues more burdensome. But out of freedom, you know, study Steiner. Go play. Go have a root beer float. Start a reading salon for Wodehouse books. So enrich each other with good, healthy, supportive conversations. And engage yourself with the world. Come up with new ideas for your class. Things that have never been done. It will enliven you. And keep praying and meditating and connecting with the spiritual world and the angels. The angel and being of your school, the ones of your students, and your own. Keep that relationship alive and active with your own angel. And yeah, be careful what you do with your time. Sometimes we need places we can go complain, find appropriate places and times, right? Emotions are physical things, right? They manifest these physical things, they manifest in physical ways. So go for a walk. Go smash some sticks if you need to, away from your students and stuff, but it's physical. Go chop some wood. Do something physical with any resentment or anger that comes up. Talk about your fears. I use something called EFT, Emotional Freedom Technique. It's a self-acupressure thing. I also do a lot of kirtan chanting. I sing. I do things outside of school, completely unrelated to school, and keep myself enriched, enlivened, and in a place of devotion and praise and gratitude as much as possible through my music, through my connections with other people. And all of that helps. So allow yourself, if you think of a piece of bread that's growing stale, it's just sitting there, it's old, untouched. Allow yourself to be touched by angels, by other people, by the divine calling that you have answered. And, yeah, so all of those things, all of these things, to be a person of initiative and initiation for yourself, your interest in the world, your self-development as an honest individual, all of these things will help that one, will help you stay fresh. Do the first three, and the fourth one comes along with it. It automatically does. So, those are the four guiding principles from Rudolf Steiner that he gave those first teachers. And I want to close a little bit with just a couple of other thoughts that he gives. He says, our Waldorf school, my dear friends, will depend upon what you do within yourselves and whether you allow the things which we have been considering to become effective in your own souls. So, somewhere he says also, think of the many things I have tried to make clear. Recall these things in your mind. Maybe there'll come moments when you feel uncertain how or when to bring one thing or another, or in what place to introduce this. But try to remember rightly what has been brought before you this fortnight. Then thoughts will surely arise, in which will tell you what to do. Of course, many things need to get repeated over and over. But I do not want to make you teaching machines. I want to make you into free, independent teachers. So I appeal to the understanding and devotion that you bring to your work. So, all of these things, he basically says to these teachers, and he's saying it to us because we have the lectures, someone stenographed them. Read them. Ask yourself questions. Have healthy conversations with other people about them in your school. Those things will keep you fresh, and as you allow them to work in your soul, everything depends on that. Of staying true to the basics. Those are the basics. be a person of initiative, be interested in the world, be an honest person, stay fresh. Those are the basics of teaching. There's a lot of other things, of course, but those are the basics. So he says, this Waldorf school is a child of care. It's his baby. And I encourage you to look at your own class and your own school as your baby. Even if you didn't found it, you're there. We are charged with helping this school, your students, be born into the world. And the last thing, for real, the last thing. Let us, in particular, keep before us this thought, which shall truly fill our hearts and minds, that bound up with the spiritual movement of the present day are also the spiritual powers that guide the universe. If we believe in these good spiritual powers, then they will be the inspirers of our lives, and we shall really be enabled to teach. Believe in them, not just spoken belief. Work with your meditation, work with your inner life, with your angels and the angels of your students. Believe in these principles in your very core. Doesn't mean you can't have doubts and ask questions. Believe that they are so and true. And that belief, right? That will give you the power to be inspired by the spiritual world that guides the universe. So ask for help in all of these. If you're feeling stale and sour, ask for some help from the angels. If you're wondering what ideas to do, really meditatively and prayerfully look at your students and ask for help. If you're feeling disdainful, scared, worried, resentful, judgmental of the world, then ask for help to have those things removed, and then actively discipline yourself to get out into the world and engage the world of your students and the world around you. If you're having trouble with honesty, if every other word's a lie and you're lying about this and you're overburdening yourself and you don't know how to say no, ask for help. The same spiritual energy that's guiding the universe is guiding you, your teaching, your students, the parents, the colleagues. So, as a typical Waldorf teacher, I've talked a lot. But there are Rudolf Steiner's four guiding principles and my broad stroke understanding of them. I hope you found this helpful and inspiring. If you need any other mentoring or consultations or any other ideas around Waldorf-inspired education, feel free to go to my website, tappingwithmusic.com, and I'd be happy to help in any way I can. I also do musical concerts, kirtan, I do EFT, so go to my website and that'll tell you all about those things. Main thing, people! Have fun. Have a great school year. Thanks for watching.